מה קורה? אני ממש מתגעגעת לכולכם. אז בואו נתחיל.
Let's sing, shall we?
Here we go.
Shall we?
Yeah.
This is Maria from my house in the old city.
This is home from Beit Halima, Jerusalem.
Hobe Ahava from Achadot.
This is Achinoam Nini.
This is Mir Awar. I love you all.
Marhaba, ana Muhammad Al-Awar min Al-Jawqa, wa biddi aghanni lkum.
This is Joanna Jones from my home in Hollywood.
It's Rami coming to you live from the French show.
I'm excited to be connected with everyone across the globe.
This is Craig Jessup from my home in Providence, Utah.
I try to use my voice as a weapon of mass connection.
This is Kira Butcher. Thank you, Baram Allah.
Hi, Irina Gaha.
Hi, I'm Sam Shuri.
I'm PC Brothers.
And I'm so happy that this song, Home, that I got to record with the JYC, is bringing so many people together at this time.
Hi, it's Alice. Hello from my home in Rehavia.
Hold on to me as we go. As we roll down this unfamiliar road. And all through this west, chain us along.
Oh,
Hello, and welcome to ALLMEP's Global Shine a Light Gala. And it really is global. We schedule it that way. So our supporters from right around the world can come and join us, whether you're waking up or having breakfast in the West Coast of the United States or on the East Coast, good afternoon. And for those of you joining us in Europe and the Middle East, good evening. And if anybody is awake further east, good morning, I suppose, also. It's been a really difficult year, and there's no point pretending otherwise. It's been dark. But as it comes towards a close, if you look around, you can begin to see some of the signs of lightness, of brightness coming through. Whether it's the vaccine, which is now beginning to be rolled out, and hopefully will be able to transform and change and improve the situation we've all been living through this pandemic over the last year, or the signs of political renewal, which maybe might help us turn a corner following the polarization and political extremism that we've seen in recent years. But there's also ALLMEP's members, over 125 organizations working every day to build a more peaceful reality between Israelis and Palestinians. As the Hanukkah song says, each one of us are a small light, but when we come together, like in a network like ALLMEP, we can shine brighter. Over the next 90 minutes or so, we're going to be joined by some incredible figures from the world of politics and entertainment, and they're going to use their star power, essentially, to shine a light on our members. But for many people, I assume this is maybe the first introduction to the Alliance for Middle East Peace, for ALLMEP. So we are the largest and fastest growing network of peace-building NGOs working amongst and between Israelis and Palestinians. We work in the region to increase effectiveness and to encourage a culture of cooperation and partnership so that our members can be more than just the sum of their parts. But we also advocate to governments right around the world for far greater resources for that work. One of the tragedies is that survey after survey and study after study shows that these programs are effective in transforming and improving the attitudes and relationships between Israelis and Palestinians, but we've never funded them at a level to truly transform communities and entire societies. And that advocacy that ALLMEP leads around the world over the last 17 years has helped to unlock over $130 million in funding for peace building in Israel and Palestine. But that's just the start. As we're speaking today, as this year comes to a close, we are on the cusp of the enactment of a piece of legislation called the Middle East Partnership for Peace Act, which promises to be the single biggest investment ever in peace building in Israel and Palestine. You're going to hear from some of the amazing figures in Congress who've been leading and championing this work. And you're also going to be hearing about some of the plans and programs that ALLMEP is putting in place to grow that funding further, bringing in other governments around the world, and also working more diligently with our members to ensure every dollar invested goes that much further. But to do all of these things, we also need your support. ALLMEP relies entirely on private philanthropy in order to do its work. We're coming towards the end of perhaps our most impactful year. We want to create the resources and the foundations to do even more next year. And that's why we're very lucky to have the support of some longstanding ALLMEP supporters in the United States, Sally Gottesman and Jane and Bob Toll, who have invested $150,000 into a matched pot, which means that the first $150,000 donated today at our Shine a Light Gala will be 100% matched. If you are ever going to support ALLMEP's work, now is the time. Every donation will go twice as far and give us the strength and the resources to make 2021 a truly breakthrough year. Now, as we try and tell the story of ALLMEP in its full historical sweep, we're going to be joined by no one better than the original founding visionary behind ALLMEP, Avi Myerstein. Now, Avi, 17 years ago, at the height of the Second Intifada, and if you think things are bad now between Israelis and Palestinians, cast your mind back to those dark days. He saw the reality that existed between peace-building colleagues and friends of his on both sides of the Green Line and couldn't square it with what he was seeing in newspapers and TV reports. So the germ, the kernel of the idea, was to bring together those organizations into one network, into one movement to have greater impact. We're very lucky to be joined by Avi now. Avi, welcome to Shine a Light.
Thank you, John. And let me just say congratulations and a huge thank you to you and the entire ALLMEP team for all of your hard work that has made this incredible event what it is. I have to say, as I think back to when we started ALLMEP 17 years ago, this moment just blows me away. Back then, it seemed that every time I turned on the news, I felt helpless watching Israelis and Palestinians who were killing each other. And it was maddening, really, because most Israelis and Palestinians said they wanted peace. They just didn't think they had a partner on the other side they could make peace with. I was sure there must be something we could do, so I looked for a way to help. I found a handful of organizations that were building cooperation and trust between people on the ground. Their work was so inspiring, but they faced incredible obstacles. Almost no one knew they existed. They were doing amazing work on shoestring budgets. They had waiting lists of people wanting to participate. Can you imagine having Israelis and Palestinians who want to work together, but you have to turn them away? So we brought these peace builders to Washington to tell their inspiring stories. The people in Congress were amazed. They had no idea this work was going on or what it could do. Year after year, we pushed for funding, and Congress answered, so far with a total of over $120 million. Those dollars have changed thousands of lives and attitudes. A single Arab-Jewish school has grown to 7 schools. A partnership for clean water between an Israeli and Palestinian neighboring towns has grown to 28 communities. A joint Memorial Day event that started with a few hundred people this year had over 200,000. But thousands of people, sadly, are not enough because the conflict is bigger. Imagine, though, what if we worked at the scale of the conflict itself? If we reached just 25% of Israelis and Palestinians, then everyone, every family, would know someone with real relationships on the other side. Every politician would know that peace had a movement behind it. To reach that kind of scale, back in 2004, I proposed that we work to create an international peace-building fund, just like the one that secured the peace in Northern Ireland. Since then, we've been on a campaign to build that fund that's taken us all around the world. We've had 6 different bills in Congress, hundreds of meetings. We've built broad bipartisan coalitions. We've had huge moments of progress and more than a few setbacks too. And then this year, in this crazy year of 2020, our bill passed the House of Representatives, and it could pass into law within the next few days. When it does, it will launch the biggest investment the world has ever made in Israeli-Palestinian peacebuilding. So today, let's celebrate the unbelievable work taking place every day and the promise for so much more. As I've learned these last 17 years, there is something that each of us can do to help Israelis and Palestinians. And that's where you can make a huge difference. Thanks to all of you for being here and for your support. The peace builders need you and all your friends and family as our partners in the exciting journey ahead. Please spread the good word. Now it's my privilege to introduce a short video that tells the story of our journey so far, of our inspiring members' work, and of the inspiration we drew from a little-known strategic fund that helped end decades of conflict in Northern Ireland.
A Palestinian sniper killed my son, David.
An Israeli soldier shot and killed my 10-year-old daughter, Abir.
When I take the bus, my parents are afraid that there might be a terrorist attack.
Jewish extremists tried to burn down my school.
With decades of division, conflict, and unsuccessful peace efforts, fear and mistrust between Israelis and Palestinians, especially among the youth, has never been greater. This is the reality that ALLMEP, the Alliance for Middle East Peace, seeks to change. ALLMEP is a coalition of over 125 organizations and tens of thousands of Palestinians and Israelis, Jews and Arabs, building the civic foundations for peace. We foster cooperation within the peace-building field and advocate to governments around the world that they should invest greater resources toward our members' work. One ALLMEP member is the Parents Circle.
To commemorate David's name, I work with Palestinians for peace.
To commemorate Abir's name, I work with Israelis for peace.
The Parents Circle is an organization of more than 600 Palestinian and Israeli families who have lost loved ones in the conflict. Together, they work for peace, for a future where no other family will have to experience such loss.
I think standing on a stage all over the world and in Israel and Palestine, together with a Palestinian partner, for me, is the most effective way. Because if we, who have suffered, can stand on the stage and are the least likely people to do this, then surely that's an example to other people.
In fact, especially because we we share the same pain. We lost our kids. And we discover that in their name, our revenge is to make peace.
Hand in Hand is another member of ALLMEP. It's a network of bilingual schools and communities in Israel where Jewish and Arab children and their families live and learn together.
Most Jewish kids in Israel don't ever get to meet Arabs, but we get to see each other every day.
It's really good that we can just sit in the same class and learn together and actually like have fun together. It's easier to fear and to hate when you don't know each other.
Through Olive Oil Without Borders, business partnerships produce more than just profits.
If it wasn't for Olive Oil Without Borders, I would never meet Palestinians. And meeting them, seeing that we are very similar, gives me hope for the future.
من خلال العمل المشترك الفلسطيني الإسرائيلي إحنا بنربح أنفسنا وبنربح السلام للجميع.
ALLMEP has so far unlocked over $130 million in government funding for Palestinian and Israeli peace builders. That has driven real change on the ground and impacted tens of thousands of lives. But we need to reach millions. That's why ALLMEP is expanding its efforts and looking to models that have worked elsewhere. Northern Ireland. There too, fear and mistrust had never been greater. After decades of division and conflict, trust between Catholics and Protestants was shattered. To most people, peace was an impossibility. Yet, the impossible was overcome. A peace agreement was signed. It holds to this day. How? By building from the bottom up. The International Fund for Ireland, a little-known strategic fund, invested over $1 billion, starting 12 years before a peace deal, in what the UK's chief negotiator said was the great unsung hero of the peace process. It built trust and sustains peace to this very day. It's time to bring this successful model to the Middle East and establish an international fund for Israeli-Palestinian peace. This isn't just an idea. Thanks to ALLMEP's advocacy, the concept was endorsed by the UK government, and bipartisan legislation has passed the US Congress, promising $250 million over 5 years toward the fund, representing the largest ever investment in Israeli-Palestinian peace building. While this is a start, it isn't enough. We need your support to bring more countries on board, so the resources available to those working for peace match the scale of the challenge. And then the thousands can become millions.
We can build trust.
We can work together.
We will make peace.
We will make peace.
We will make peace together with your support. Help us make the International Fund for Israeli-Palestinian Peace a reality.
That video gives a really good sense of ALLMEP's 10-year campaign now to create this breakthrough international fund for Israeli-Palestinian peace. But now to dig a little bit deeper into the work that ALLMEP is doing across three continents, really, we're delighted to be joined by Sanam Shantyaei, who is a journalist and presenter of Middle East Matters on France 24 and has platformed so many of our members and their work and peace builders in the Middle East more generally. Sanam, great to be with you. Thanks for joining us for Shine a Light.
John, thank you very much for that kind introduction. As you've just mentioned, I've been covering the story for a number of years, and I'm fortunate enough to have this weekly program on France 24, Middle East Matters. We really do strive to provide a platform for those that are fighting for peace between Israel and Palestine, and we try and amplify their voices. This at a time when it appears that certain players in the international community and some media outlets are choosing to look in the other direction. Now, enough about me. I'd like to introduce the senior staff at ALLMEP who work, and I know this very much so, they work tirelessly across three different continents, and I want to delve into the extraordinary work that they do. So I'm now joined by Huda Arghoub. She's the regional director, and Kevin Rachlin, he's the US director, and none other than John Linden, who's the executive director at ALLMEP. It's fantastic to speak to you guys. John, let's start with you. As we just heard in some of the videos in the comments earlier, ALLMEP very much draws on the conflict in Northern Ireland for inspiration on how to penetrate palpable change in Israel and Palestine. What do you think can be learned from the approach in Northern Ireland? And how is ALLMEP implementing those ideas today?
Thanks so much, Sanam. Well, look, I mean, no two conflicts are ever the same, but we have so few models for successfully resolved conflicts really over the last few hundred years. And Northern Ireland does have quite a few parallels as well as some important differences. And for anybody watching this evening who remembers the reality in Northern Ireland or has studied it in the late 1980s, there's a lot of parallels that do come to mind. I mean, people talked, and I remember this, about the conflict being irresolvable, being with us forever. We had a situation where politicians couldn't be in the same room with each other, where violence was a daily occurrence. Racism, dehumanization, and polarization were constantly on the uptick, particularly amongst young people. And if that sounds familiar for those of us working on Israel-Palestine, it's because that's what embedded conflict does to a society. Now, what's interesting and different in Northern Ireland is that the international community saw the conflict as a tough problem to be solved, rather than a political can to kick around. And so they saw these variables terribly misaligned in the late 1980s and said, you know what, we're going to invest at scale and change them. And as we heard in that video, over $1 billion invested into a relatively small society starting 12 years before a peace deal managed to create the relationships, the organizations, the capacity, the momentum to really transform that reality in the late 1980s into one where we saw a conflict-ending deal arriving in the late 1990s, and one that is very much embedded now with a generation who have largely moved on from the conflict that preceded it. So there are a lot of things that are different in Israel-Palestine, but that particular model, the only thing stopping us from implementing it in the Middle East is simply political will and resources, which why we're obviously excited to be on the cusp of that lesson being learned by politicians on both sides of the Atlantic.
Let's now shift the attention from politics. Huda, you've been an activist and a leader for peace for many years. You've worked closely with both Israeli and Palestinian civil society. How do you think, and this is certainly for the more cynical individuals here, civil society can really impact the political challenges that we're seeing at the very top, at the elite level? And how does that come into the equation in leading ALLMEP's regional office, which is exactly what you do?
Thank you, Sanam. We're very grateful for you because you are one of few journalists who actually shine a light on this work. To answer your question, I think we need to learn from experiences of other conflict zones like Liberia, Tunisia, and Ireland, where when systems failed completely to respond to people's aspirations, the civil society was the only answer for to prevent a total collapse. And this is what informs our work in the regional office. We need to continue to support this work because it's on the only guarantee, at least now, for not the thousands of Israelis and Palestinians to engage in a violent kind of interaction. Thousands of Palestinians and Israelis are determined and have the capacity to change the conflict dynamics. All we need as ALLMEP is to raise the funds for them to do that, raise their capacity to scale, and help them continue to do the work, the very difficult but yet very needed work on the ground.
Absolutely. And Kevin, as John mentioned earlier, did I interrupt you? I'm sorry, Huda.
No, thank you.
Kevin, as John mentioned earlier, the US actually invested unprecedented resources in peace building in Northern Ireland, establishing an international fund, helping to set the foundation for genuine conflict resolution. ALLMEP is also campaigning for a rather similar approach in the Middle East. And this year, I'm very proud to say, is on the cusp of an historic breakthrough in that effort. How have you built the coalition in support of this approach? And can you tell us what this legislation means for the region?
Absolutely. So on the first, I would say lots of shoe leather and lots of hard work. but seriously, this coalition has been built around this effort. Republicans and Democrats in Congress and NGOs across the spectrum, like the American Jewish Committee, APEC, J Street, the Jewish Federations of North America, the Anti-Defamation League, they've all come around because this work works. Peace building and people-to-people activity works. And more importantly, everyone agrees at this point that it rises above the everyday politics that are happening in Washington. Passing the Middle East Partnership for Peace Act will do more than set the cornerstone for this idea of an international fund. It will provide the largest single investment in peace building activity in the region ever. Just to give you some context on that, Last year, the U.S. government appropriated $30 million for the Office of Conflict Management Mitigation, and about $6 million of it were spent in the region, and most of it within the Green Line. The Middle East Partnership for Peace Act would invest $110 million in people-to-people activity over 5 years, an average of $22 million per year. Just think of what those resources can do, dramatically increasing the size of programs, and more importantly, giving every Israeli and every Palestinian not only the ability to participate, but the right to participate in these programs.
Now, staying with the international fund idea, John, given the name itself, surely that paves the way for more than just U.S. involvement. Has there been, is there interest from Europe and other corners of the world to be a part of this initiative?
Absolutely, Sanam. I mean, the name is there for a reason. This needs to be an international fund, bringing in legitimate funders from around the world who care about Middle Eastern peace in order to scale up the resources, but also the legitimacy for any instrument like this. And in fact, the first government in the world to endorse the fund was the government of the United Kingdom. Almost 3 years ago, Stewart endorsed the concept in the House of Commons. And only just a few weeks ago, we had a 90-minute debate in Westminster where politicians, MPs from every single political party in Parliament stood up and every one of them endorsed this concept. Now, for those familiar with British politics right now, to have everybody agree on this policy is a real testament to the win-win way in which it's being framed and mirroring the bipartisanship that Kevin has helped to build in the United States. So we hope that, Britain will be moving forward with this next year. The minister at the end of that debate said that he'll begin discussions with the incoming Biden administration, but that's again not enough. We've had high-level conversations with the French government, the Germans, the European Union, the Australians, the Japanese, the Canadians. This is why we need further support to continue to expand the advocacy. And even thinking about the recent normalization deals with states in the Gulf, there is now the possibility in the future of Gulf states joining this and us getting towards that $200 million a year, every year, that's necessary to make these programs a right, as Kevin was saying, rather than a rare privilege.
Now, Huda, this is a lot of money that we're talking about, which is poised to trickle into this peace-building field that you're a part of. Are you prepared for this? Are they prepared for this? And of course, we want to know what ALLMEP's role is on the ground in ensuring that this investment yields the maximum impact.
Sanam, we are not just prepared. We are ready and we're hungry for more. Thousands of Palestinians and Israelis are waiting for the moment where their capacity is going to be raised to the extent, to the next level, where their impact is going to be seen, where they will be recognized as a legitimate player in this conflict. We're prepared to do that. We're tapping on the potential of thousands of Palestinians and Israelis who've done all kinds of programs in the Alumni Leadership Forum. We're putting together a program for 3 years to raise the capacity of the field. We're turning our community from being individual organizations fighting for the resources out there to being a community, to being a movement that is going to change the dynamics of this conflict. All we need is for people to keep having faith in us.
Faith is needed. I'm afraid I have one final question now, and this is for any of you. What does the incoming Biden administration mean for all of this? And actually, more importantly, this is something that I would ask as a journalist. What does it mean, more broadly speaking, for Israel and Palestine?
I think I'll take this one. So the incoming Biden administration provides a number of opportunities to reexamine the conflict and the United States' role in it. I believe that the new administration will take a pulled back approach to Israel and Palestine, focusing mainly on civil society and reestablishing the relationship between the United States and the Palestinians. As for this effort that we're currently undertaking, the Middle East Partnership for Peace Act provides them a toolkit to do something truly transformative, pushing the United States to lead on a multilateral endeavor to change the status quo on the ground in the region. Peace building, it's not easy, nor is it quick. It's not a quick fix. Too many people expect the conflict to end when a peace deal is signed, but it won't without the population getting behind their leaders. So many former negotiators that we have worked with and so many have written about their failure and about how there was no constituency for peace. ALLMEP intends to challenge this incoming administration and the nations around the world to stand up and invest in peace. And on that note, it is my distinct honor and my distinct pleasure and privilege to introduce one of the original congressional champions of this effort, Congressman Jeff Fortenberry from Nebraska. Congressman Fortenberry has been a staunch supporter of People-to-People Act work in the region and the idea of an international fund since ALLMEP first presented it to him. It was he who first introduced the original version of this bill and has been an unbelievable ally in Congress, whipping his colleagues to join this effort. I can't thank Congressman Fortenberry and his staff enough for their dedication to peace and their support of the Alliance for Middle East Peace. Congressman Fortenberry?
First, let me thank you all, members and leaders of the Alliance for Middle East Peace. We've talked for a long time. We've had good relationships. We've thought together. We've imagined together. I just really want to thank you sincerely from the bottom of my heart for your mission, for your idealism, and for your practicality. And we're on the verge of something very, very big. The Middle East Partnership for Peace Act is possibly going to be included in this year's appropriations bills. I'm very, very proud of that. We've worked so hard to achieve a new positive vision for what can happen when we bring people together and we tie them economically in projects that are mutually beneficial for all parties. I want to thank my good friend, Congresswoman, and my chair of appropriations, Nita Lowey, for her stalwart commitment to these ideals. We often talk about a roadmap for peace in the Middle East, but any road needs a foundation, and this is a foundation. Bringing people together in traditional programs, but also leveraging some new ideas out there, the Development Finance Initiative, so that we can use equity investments to create a continuity of opportunity that benefits all persons. This doesn't happen, though, without commitment. So again, the commitment of my chair, Nita Lowey, to thinking creatively and imaginatively and putting her stamp of approval on this brings huge, huge credibility to the whole process that so many of us have worked so many years on. It does seem intractable that somehow we could achieve peace in a region where there's been long divides and scores to settle and great pain and division. This is the 21st century, though, and I think all of us are looking for new architectures, a new way of thinking about how we maybe bring together the possibility of healing wounds, looking forward, recreating possibilities, and doing that which is just and good in order to overcome that which may have been considered unjust and wrong and hurtful. It takes a commitment of America, though, a lot of times to do these things, so I'm proud of my country for my colleagues for considering this. I'm proud of your efforts creating the preconditions in which Congress can potentially act. And now it's time to simply get it done. So hopefully the Middle East Partnership for Peace Act will become law very soon. And my task today was again to simply thank you, my friends, for all of your good work. Let's stay with it. Let's get it over the finish line. And then after we're done, we can have a wonderful celebration about a new chapter potentially for humanity, for civilization, for the principles of justice and goodness. Thank you so much.
Hello. I thought it's essential to talk about the importance of real human relationships within a conflict like the one Israel and Palestine are experiencing for so many years. And the importance of really knowing the other side as a core component of building peace. Theories are not enough. People need to meet each other to overcome the fears they inherited, often mainly created by what they've been taught to think about the others. And it's probably the same misconception on both sides of the border. People are told that they're different, but when it comes to a personal level, not on a political one, families are the same on both sides. They obviously laugh and cry for the same things. And why they express is that they deeply really want to achieve peace and to live a normal life. To remember that they have the same culture. And even though their differences are real, they're beautiful. And after all, yes, it's true. Very often, their hummus tastes exactly the same. ALLMEP's members work to create that exact bond, that knowledge, that humanization. And if every Palestinian and Israeli would have such experiences as a right, rather than a rare privilege from time to time, then it could probably transform the broken politics and create the foundations for a real, just, and equitable peace. Many of ALLMEP's members harness the power of arts and culture in that process. Art is such an important tool, and the potential of ALLMEP's international fund to make such things universal for young Israelis and Palestinians is essential and needs all the possible support. Thank you for all the incredible work that you have already done, and I really hope you can go way, way further together in the coming years.
Thank you, Laetitia. I want to thank also Congressman Fortenberry for his incredible leadership on the Middle East Partnership for Peace Act, making it truly a bipartisan effort. And also Laetitia for her excellent comments there. I mean, people may know Laetitia Eido most prominently for her role as Dr. Shirin in the Israeli TV series Fauda, but she was also a participant in the program of one of our members, Yalla Youth Leaders, that brings together emerging leaders from across the region. And that's a great segue to the next part of Shine a Light, where we're going to be joined by a very special guest to talk about the youth organizations working in this space and really transforming that lived experience for young people that Laetitia alluded to. And we're very, very lucky to be joined by the actor Jason Isaacs. Now, Jason may be best known for his role as Lucius Malfoy in Harry Potter, so that's playing a baddie. But I can tell you, over the last few weeks talking about this event, he's definitely one of life's good guys. He's been a longtime supporter of refugee rights, fighting against political extremism, and also for a just and equitable peace in the Middle East, and particularly around this role of youth. So, Jason, thank you so much for joining us.
Well, I don't know if it's worse being an evil wizard or being what I've been most of my life, John, which is a terrible cynic. I mean, like many people watching, I'm sure I've had my hopes raised and dashed throughout my life for Hope in the Middle East. And I'm feeling a bit nervous, oddly, for someone who probably performs more than other people, because my foundations are shaking. The people I've met through you the last couple of days when we rehearsed and are beginning to make me feel like there's a chance that something better can happen. And obviously our generation, I'm older than you, my generation maybe, have failed terribly. But tonight we're meeting people that make me feel that maybe the seeds of hope are planted. I do want to say one thing before we go into the panel though, because it's something that occurred, you know, that I was continually stumbling over. You don't get any of this money, right? ALLMEP doesn't get any of the money that you're raising from Congress, and you want money tonight. This is a fundraiser, let's not forget. You're after people giving you money so that you can free up funds for many other countries. Am I getting that right?
That's exactly right, Jason.
Okay. Good, because just there might be people watching thinking, well, why? That's all very well. Why should I donate when hundreds of millions of dollars are coming? You don't get a penny of it. This is all whatever you raise tonight and any other fundraising efforts in order to free up money from hopefully now a bunch of other countries around the world who are expressing interest.
Exactly. If we can do it, if we can be resourced properly okay. To do this work next good. Year, we can bring more companies on board.
Good. That's how we expand. Okay, good. Fantastic. So let's get on with the panel. You've given me a very... I know you're standing there with the stopwatch, so we're going to do some speed dating tonight. There's a panel here, you know, Palestinian and Israeli youth have probably never been more separated. There's the physical barriers, you know, the walls and so many obstacles to them meeting physically, but psychologically there's probably more hatred and division, mistrust than ever before. But there is a subset, there's an anomaly of people who have come through many of the extraordinary programs. We've only got a chance to meet a few people tonight who work with Palestinian and Israeli youth. But what I want you to, and they're under very strict instructions to not speak for very long. Any one of them could host an entire evening with the extraordinary work they do. But we're going to have a quick smorgasbord and let's see if they can further dismantle my cynicism. They're drawn from across ALLMEP membership. And I just want you to imagine when you're talking to them, what could happen if these programs were expanded enormously? Hi, everyone. I'm sorry that I'm going to be rushing you like you're on the Today program. But first, we're going to talk to Jonathan Kabiri from Seeds of Peace, which is a camp program, if I understand it, summer camps and other camps, which you went through. You were in the first one. So what was it like for you going through as a camper? And how do you take that experience through and work with people today?
First of all, thank you, sir, for hosting this panel and for the support. And for your question, so I was born after the Oslo Accords failure. And like most Israelis my age, I grew up hearing almost nothing about Palestinians and about the occupation. So I met Palestinians for the first time when I was 15. I went to Seeds of Peace summer camp and I had the chance to engage in facilitated dialogue with them and learn about the reality of life under Israeli occupation. I've learned that the work of peace building in this region does not begin or end in one summer camp experience. It is a never-ending kind of personal work. And with Seeds of Peace, I learned how to ask questions and have this internal conversation with myself and with others about my identity, my responsibilities, choices, about my fears and my dreams. And I also found a community of so many more wonderful dreamers who, despite the hardships, work together in solidarity and partnership to create more dialogue spaces and to reimagine a region and a world that is free from all kinds of oppression. A world that is better also for house elves, Mr. Malfoy.
Thanks very much. And are you still in touch with any of the people you were at camp with when you were in 2011?
So yes, I am. You know, it goes on and off with the years, and I've learned that the journey in this kind of work is a long-range journey, and you can go more closer and take some distance to breathe, and overall, it's a marathon. It's not a sprint.
Well, I'm desperate to ask you about romances, about Romeo and Juliet romances, but we don't have time, so I'll have to talk to you off. But thanks very much, Jonathan. Next, we're going to talk to Amira Syed of Tomorrow's Women. I understand you work with young Palestinian women. It says here, I've got a bunch written me, a facilitation role. What does that mean? What do you do with young women? And how has the work you've done, has it led to them becoming leaders? How are they carrying that work forward into their communities?
Thank you for this question. At Tomorrow's Women, formerly called Creativity for Peace, we dedicate our mission to only working with young women, as you just mentioned, empowering them to lead their people to achieve peace and to make a difference in their community. Since 2003, we have worked with hundreds of teenage girls from Palestine, Israel, and the United States. Our journey starts with a transformational summer camp in the US, where we, the facilitator, make sure that these young women have a safe space to share their personal stories about how living in a conflict has impacted their lives, and the expert facilitator to help them to shift their feelings of fears into empathy and respect by our unique method that we use in Tomorrow's Women that combined compassionate dialogue and art therapy. And we don't stop here. Their journey continues when these young women came back home from the camp from the US. We meet them in several seminars, and these seminars designed in a way to empower them and to provide them with knowledge, awareness, and all the tools they want to become the activists they want to be in their community.
So how long has the program been running for?
The program in the US for 3 weeks, and the follow-up program, the seminars, following a year. 1 year.
No, I mean, how long have you been around?
Me, myself?
No, I would never ask your age. That would be very rude. No, I mean, how long has the program been around?
Yes. Since 2003, the program started.
So are you seeing the fruits of that? Are you seeing women becoming leaders or becoming activists and achieving things?
Yes. So this is our vision, that these girls become tomorrow's women. And like many already have, in our 18 years history, our alumni, they are already around the world working across many sectors, speaking at the World Economic Forum, working in the United Nations and the Harvard negotiation. This is Fantastic. Just a few examples. They are trying their best promoting peace building to achieve peace when the occupation will end and justice and human rights prevail in Israel and Palestine. And this is how we believe we deserve to live. Thank you,
Amira. Thanks very much. Sorry to jump on, and I'm also getting things flashing up on the screen going, stop talking so much. Next, we're going to talk to Tamar Chai-Sagiv from the Perez Center for Peace and Innovation. I was lucky enough to see Shimon Peres speak before he died. I found him incredibly inspirational. All of his hope was for young people to save us. And the Middle East has got one of the youngest regions on Earth, I think. Half the population are under 24. What do you see when you work with young people across the region, and what... And what are your hopes for them?
So I have to say that I'm super excited from this panel. I'm inspired by each one of my colleagues here. And thank you also, sir, for the questions, because Yeah, we're talking a lot about Israel-Palestine, but we also need to look around us about also about the region. The youth has a voice in the region, and this is what the Paris Center also is doing for the last 24 years, working locally and regionally and building tomorrow's future by bringing the young generation into joint project, either by sports or by entrepreneurship or environmental project. You name it, any theme, any tool is something for us that we can use in order to bring them together to do something. This is how we define the Paris Center, not a think tank, as a do tank, because by doing, we believe that we can definitely break down those barriers and shape a better tomorrow for the people that lives in this region. In this field for the last 16 years, almost, and this is for me a huge journey. Because I can echo my friend Jonathan here. He was born after the Oslo Accords. I was already a teenager and not really in favor of the word peace. I had lots of, I would say, hatred towards the other. And through my job, this was the way I was compensating or changing the way I was educated to kind of to hate the other. And to change the reality for the younger generation that doesn't have those daily opportunities to come together, to look in the eyes of one another and really understand that they are human beings like us, that, yeah, there are differences between us, but the differences are not to be a threat on each other. We need to accept those differences, but also understand that we share lots of things in common. So by doing all those joint projects for the last 24 years as the Paris Center for Peace, this is what we're doing. We're building the human infrastructure for a better tomorrow, for tomorrow's peace.
I'm sure he's looking down and thinking that he was right and that it was working. Just sadly, he wasn't around to see it. But I'm sorry, I've got to jump on, Tamal, because I'm going to talk to Rowan Aboulafi of the Middle East Entrepreneurs of Tomorrow. And there's a link because when I saw Shimon Peres, he talked almost exclusively about Twitter and Facebook and how he felt like the internet and technology was the future that was going to allow people to know each other across political divides and ignorance. So, Rowan, first of all, tell us some of what you do. What are some of the cool technological initiatives that your alumni are working on and how this unique 21st century approach to peace building might bear fruit?
Thank you for your question. At MEET, we bring together and empower the Middle East entrepreneurs of tomorrow. We view technology as the common language between youth on both sides of the conflict. And more than that, as an important tool for future leaders and social entrepreneurs. In partnership with MIT since 2004, we teach teenagers computer science, entrepreneurship, and we foster skills, leadership, and teamwork in diverse settings. In a gradual process, we create a sense of community and connection, a positive experience for learning and working together. And this year, we're very proud that we've been doing that online. We have to remind ourselves that technology is not neutral, and it is our responsibility to positively use it to impact our societies. And that's exactly what our students and alumni are doing. They're using technology to fight the pandemic, to fight fake news, social norms, and even build houses on Mars. The potential is endless.
So wait, there are companies that are have Arabs and Israelis in them that are out there. Tell us, we're almost out of time, so tell us something, give us a company or a product that someone's made.
I think something that we're very proud of is our students building a Google Chrome extension to fight fake news. Especially this year, we've been seeing it all over the news, and this is something that our students are working hard to fight.
Right. I was hoping you were going to say they could beam us up somewhere. Obviously, and we're all
hopefully in a couple of years.
Me too. Okay, so I'm going to skip on. I know whoever's flashing signs, I know that I'm out of time, but I'm just not going to stop because we're very lucky. We've got two more people to speak to. Hoda Barakat from Hands of Peace. Hoda, I hear this phrase a lot about dialogue. We foster dialogue. What does that mean, to fostering dialogue? What do those conversations achieve? What have you seen them achieve? And it's the sort of conversations Israelis and Palestinians don't normally have. Where do you see that going? And what have you seen it going places?
Yeah, the dialogue process is a very long process. It takes years to master. In Hands of Peace, we use dialogue as our major tool to work with the youth, especially in their first encounters. They come in with a debate mindset, and we try to shift that into building trust, giving some space for that and letting it get out of the way and then focus on the personal stories. Once you humanize the other, hear the personal stories, hear the pain and the suffering, you can no longer dismiss that and dismiss your responsibility in that pain, in that suffering. And you start to work together as a group to see where is your responsibility in lifting injustice, in creating a just peace, a human rights for everybody.
I'm sorry, they're flashing, telling me to finish, but can I ask you one other thing? Are you ready for a ton of money? Can you expand? Are you ready to upscale?
Of course, we have many programming that is pending on money. And so we have a lot of ideas, a lot of staff, a lot of potential, a lot of alumni who are ready and eager. We just need some push to help us in the right direction. And I would like to add, as a Palestinian, I cannot afford to be a cynic. I remain a believer in peace because that's the only way to have my rights, my justice. I cannot afford to be a cynic, and I hope you will change your mind after.
It's happening as we speak.
Stories. And that's basically what's been driving me for the last 14 years, working with the youth, seeing those stories, those amazing transformations, such as Jonathan, such as Tamar. Those are very inspiring, and that's exactly what we need more of in this world.
Thank you. Thank you, Hoda. And finally, Sarah, don't feel pressurized that we're, 10 minutes over. It's Sarah Aweda from Jerusalem Peace Builders. Jerusalem is at the very heart of everything. It's been the heart of conflict for centuries, but it has a special role in this conflict. And the young residents, Jewish and Palestinian residents, live next to each other, but they're universes apart. Tell us about how you bring them together and what you hope to accomplish, and why I shouldn't be a cynic.
Thank you very much for your question. Let me start by the words of the great South African leader, Nelson Mandela, who famously said, if you want to make peace with your enemy, you have to work with your enemy, then you become partners. Nelson Mandela's words reflect the essence of Jerusalem Peace Builders' approach. Our mission is to raise up a new generation of Jewish, Christian, Muslim, and Druze leaders who are committed to partnership and peaceful change. Our year-round programs focus on a triangle of transformation. This triangle of youth, parents, and also teachers, by developing these three key sectors and leadership, Jerusalem Peace Builders enters the heart of the society. We create all together, and we all face the conflict issues together. So we create and we all create with our young leaders and become partners and create a multi-faith family filled with trust, support, and a safe space to share. Now, let's talk about a little bit, if we have time, about GPB's unique four-year program.
I don't think we have got time for that. I'm getting the big signs flashing up. What I would urge anyone to do, apart from give money tonight, is to look up any one of these programs, but also Sarah's, who I've cut short.
I just want to mention a small thing.
Go for it.
Okay. We work with students both in classrooms during the school year and during the summer. We'll help them to build themselves, understand their identities, how to communicate, and have leadership. I wish that I had this chance before. I wish that I was introduced to one of these old programs before. And I hope that one day in the future, my kids will get this chance. And my niece and nephew and everyone around me, every Palestinian, as a Palestinian, I say, because we Palestinians and Israelis, we live in Jerusalem but side by side, but we're far away because the land is in the Palestinian-Israeli conflict involves the land, and the land is the main part, central part of each person's identity. So we hope someday we can negotiate identities and work together in peace. In Jerusalem Peace Builders, ALLMEP, and all my colleagues over here, we walk this road every day together. So okay.
I've got to stop you, Sarah, but thank you so much. And so the walls of my cynicism are unquestionably cracking, but I do have to remind everyone watching that they do this extraordinary work on a very small section of the Israeli and Palestinian population. They're hoping to get a ton of money from America to be able to do it with more people, but unlocking money from the various other countries that expressed interest needs ALLMEP to go and advocate, needs ALLMEP to shake the tree. That's how this money's arrived, because ALLMEP has been working for it. They don't get any of this money or these grants. They will get money if you donate tonight. So please, if this is moving you, if it's interesting you, please donate now. You can see the stuff on the screen. So now it would have been my great pleasure to chat to a fellow Starship captain. But unfortunately, Sir Patrick Stewart has had to pull out. He was very upset about that. He has sent a video, so I almost get to hand over to him by saying, Sir Patrick, the bridge is yours.
I am a supporter of what you will be hearing and what you will be discussing. I believe in Israel, and I believe in the Palestinian cause. I believe in developing foundational practices of respect and dialogue, and interfaith and intercultural understanding. And it can be brought about by people like you, young people like you. I was fortunate to work in Israel and to spend a little vacational time there. And the highlight of that time was several hours that I spent in Ramallah, which I shall never forget. Believe in yourselves, and peace will be yours, your families, and your friends for the rest of time. Bye.
Thank you, Sir Patrick. I'm a huge fan. My name is Wasim Al-Masri. I am the Regional Program Manager for ALLMEP. I've helped build ALLMEP's Alumni Leadership Forum, ALF, in which we worked with our members to ensure that the tens of thousands of people who passed through their programs are playing a meaningful role in building peace.
This year, I'm proud to be launching Mideast Storytellers. It's an online festival and competition that celebrates the inspiring stories of Palestinian and Israeli peace activists and those who found their way to the Holy Land because they deeply believe in a future where Palestinians and Israelis can live in peace.
I long for a future where such peaceful days are the norm.
I learned that the solution to division and conflict is within us.
Life is all about stories. I am interested in the stories we are told.
At ALLMEP, we believe that the conflict is not only shaped by political discourse, but also by the voices of the people and their struggle to live in dignity, equality, and most importantly, peace. Mideast Storytellers is a platform for these voices to be heard and acknowledged. There's no shame in demanding peace. Mideast Storytellers is developed by our partner Pendulum and co-sponsored by ALLMEP and our wonderful friends at Bait of Hope. Please follow us on Instagram as we will share more stories in the coming weeks leading to the project unveiling in January.
I'd now like to introduce Congresswoman Nita Lowey of New York. As chair of the House Committee on Appropriation, Congresswoman Lowey is one of the chief architects of the $250 million Middle East Partnership for Peace Act and a consistent champion of our members and their work throughout her tenure on Capitol Hill, meeting several of them last year in Jerusalem and expressing her support. We are very grateful for your leadership. Congresswoman Lowey.
It's a pleasure to take part in today's virtual gala. I only wish we could be meeting in person, but I hope that you and your loved ones are safe and well. Today's event is yet another example of how we are all adapting to a new reality while finding innovative ways to continue our vital work. And I want to thank you for what you are doing to carry on critically important peace-building efforts between Israelis and Palestinians. As I prepare to retire from the Congress after 32 years and reflect on many wonderful partnerships and friendships, the Alliance for Middle East Peace is certainly at the top of the list. I've often said I couldn't leave Congress until Middle East peace was achieved between Israel and the Palestinians. And it does break my heart to be leaving at a time when we are nowhere close to that reality. Yet your incredible work, forging partnerships between people of different backgrounds, faiths, and experiences, continues to give us all hope that the dream of peace will someday be a reality. We know there are no shortcuts to peace, which is why even in the face of global pandemics and unthinkable budget cuts, ALLMEP's members have tirelessly fought to keep their programs going. I applaud you for all the sacrifices and late nights this must require. It's my fervent wish that before I retire, I will have helped cement congressional support for your work through passage of the Middle East Partnership for Peace Act. Together, we have come so far to advance this legislation through the House of Representatives with broad bipartisan support. I want to thank my dear friend and colleague, Congressman Jeff Fortenberry, for his partnership on this effort. We are working hard at work, urging the Senate to follow suit, and we know you are doing all you can as well. The scope of your people-to-people program is so impressive, from addressing conflict resolution to teaching young minds how to code, from finding new energy and water solutions to forming all-girls soccer and basketball teams. The possibilities from collaboration and cooperation are endless. With congressional support and a dedicated source of funding, one can only imagine how many more lives you could reach and indelibly impact. With all the talent and goodwill of your members and participants, and the passion of all those watching this year's gala, I'm certain we will make this goal happen. I thank you for all that you do and for the gifts of your friendship and partnership. Stay safe. I hope to see you soon.
ALLMEP does two things exceedingly well. It advocates in the halls of Congress and in political chambers worldwide to have governments allocate more money to the people-to-people work that Israelis and Palestinians are engaged in the region.
That one dimension is advocacy, politics, diplomacy, but another one, which is as important as the first one, is civil society and people-to-people work. And this is why I actually joined ALLMEP, and realizing, by the way, that the separation between the two societies, Israeli and Palestinians, is very large and deep. The amount of distrust and dehumanization is very disturbing. And this is where, you know, ALLMEP actually plays a very important role.
It's creating a cadre of peace builders, people who will be willing, once the political powers sign an agreement, to translate it into reality.
You need to bridge the large gap in terms of mistrust between the two societies. So.
And that's why I support ALLMEP.
Thank you, Giorgio and Joanna, and the entire board at ALLMEP globally for all the support and leadership that you provide us in all our work and this expansion that we've been undergoing over the last few years. And I wanted to also once again thank Congresswoman Lowey, as she's marking the end of 31 years of incredible service in the US Congress. I think it's fair to say nobody really has pursued this international fund, this Middle East Partnership for Peace Act project, with as much determination and enthusiasm as Congresswoman Lowey. And the best way to mark that legacy of her time in office is to have this enacted into law, which may happen as soon as this week, and then paying dividends for generations to come for the Israelis and Palestinians who stand to benefit from this unprecedented investment in Israeli and Palestinian peace building. But again, it really isn't enough. We need to expand in 2021 using the headwinds of the incoming Biden administration, this incoming culture of multilateralism, which is now once again back on the agenda, to build an international fund with a target of $200 million per annum every single year invested in Israeli and Palestinian peace building, getting us roughly to the same per person per year spend that we saw made such a huge difference in Northern Ireland. But it's not just that. We also want to make every single dollar that our advocacy secures work all that much harder in order to be as efficiently used and as efficiently leveraged as possible. That's why we're rolling out programming in January of next year that is going to work with building capacity, particularly in the cross-border field, to invest in an emerging generation of social entrepreneurs, as you heard in Wasim's video earlier on, who will be able to think up together and cooperate on new programs that are rooted in cooperation and partnership that can reach numbers of Israelis and Palestinians that cross-border peace building has never before impacted. But to do all this, we're going to need your help. So I think, you know, as has been said already by Jason very, very accurately, we depend on private philanthropy in order to unlock these unprecedented sums from governments around the world. I don't know of a return on investment, particularly in the Middle East peace building space, that's as significant as an organization with a budget of less than $1 million every year that has unlocked over $130 million and is on the cusp of unlocking $250 million. So if you can dig deep and support our work today, we'd be endlessly grateful. We're very, very close to exhausting the first match that was so generously put forward. We've $267,000 donated so far during Shine a Light, but I have some extraordinary news. Thanks to the generosity of two European supporters, a $100,000 grant from a European supporter in London and a $75,000 donation from a Swiss foundation, we now have $175,000 of additional matched money on offer for the rest of today, for the rest of Shine a Light. So we need you to support us right now. No donation ever made to ALLMEP will go as far as one that comes in today, not just because of the matched opportunity that's on offer, but also because of the pivot point that we are at, both our international organization in Europe and the United States, but also the team in the region, the programs you're putting together. Right now, with an investment of resources as this year comes to an end, we can design and roll out programs next year, fully resourced and staffed, that can drive home this momentum and transform the reality of bottom-up peace building amongst Israelis and Palestinians. Now, one person who knows a thing or two about bottom-up peace building and how it was developed in Northern Ireland is former UK Prime Minister Tony Blair. He also was the former Quartet representative, banging his head against the wall very often with the Israeli-Palestinian conflict that was stuck in such an impasse. And he recognized that that civil society capacity built by the International Fund for Ireland, which his chief negotiator called the great unsung hero of the Good Friday Agreement, was simply missing in Israel-Palestine. And that's why he was one of the very first international advocates and supporters for the International Fund. And we're privileged to have him join us now to say a few words of why that was the case.
Hello, everyone. I'm delighted to say these few words at the winter event of the Alliance for Middle East Peace. And thanks to John and Huda and Kevin for putting the event together. As one of the architects of the Good Friday Agreement that brought peace to Northern Ireland, I know that that peace process and its success didn't begin or come to fruition in a vacuum. There were many great things that happened before we ever got to the negotiation that set the context, laid the ground, created the environment for the negotiation to succeed. One of those things was the International Fund for Ireland. That was a fund that supported projects both in the loyalist and nationalist communities, traversed all the differences between those two communities, brought them together, and that fund, with its sources of funding from the United States and from the Commonwealth, played a major part in setting the scene for what then became a successful Northern Ireland peace negotiation. I believe that the Middle East Fund, which I've been very happy and privileged to support, can do exactly the same for the Israeli-Palestinian conflict. We know in the end that it will take a negotiation in order to bring a lasting peace. But we know too that without the people on both sides of the conflict coming together, having some sense of a shared future, having a purpose where they can see a real benefit in peace, that that is also going to be of huge importance. And the Fund for Middle East Peace can provide exactly the same source of stability that the Israeli-Palestinian conflict as it did for the Northern Ireland peace process. So I'm very happy to say these words in support of the fund, to wish everyone well, and to say that even though I stepped back from being the quartet representative on the Middle East peace process some years ago, I still remain very active with my institute in that peace process. And I still, despite everything, I'm an optimist that ultimately peace will prevail. If it does, then initiatives like the Alliance for Middle East Peace will have played a crucial part. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Tony Blair, for this message and for all his support of this effort over the last few years. Now, we know that in conflict and in any polarization in society, education is one of the most critical elements. At the opinion formation age for young people, the experiences, the relationships, the knowledge that they get through, that they have imbibed in those years, it can go on and frame the rest of their lives in ways that are truly transformative. But the other thing that we do know about education is that it's quite expensive. It needs to be institutionalized. And when it's done properly, it needs to be done at a sustainable scale that can include and transform hundreds of thousands of people within a society. And that's why education is one of the most important areas of ALLMEP's membership, where we see the transformative potential of the International Fund. It also happens to be the part of ALLMEP's membership where you see some of the most interesting innovation and entrepreneurship and how the field of education has evolved over the last few decades. I bang on about Northern Ireland very often, but actually in Israel, in the shared society field, there is world leadership in the field of education going on. It just needs to be at the scale necessary to transform the underlying reality. That's why we're going to have a panel focused right now on the field of education to meet some of the leaders and the social entrepreneurs who've been designing and rolling out these programs. And why we're delighted to welcome back Jason Isaacs to help lead that conversation. Jason, welcome back.
Hi, that Tony Blair is quite a good speaker. You should think about doing it for a living. So you do bang on about Northern Ireland, John, but I have to remind you that it's not been the perfect success story. I think it's something like less than half of the schools are integrated. Still, two-thirds of the schools, I think, are still segregated. Is that right?
That's correct. Exactly. It's fallen behind. And this is where I think the reality in Israel and some of the ideas and innovation can actually, they can teach teachers and educators in Northern Ireland. There's a lot to be learned. And this, again, it's why the International Fund is such an interesting instrument to scale excellent ideas already there, but just a bit too embryonic.
Right. And I'm just going to, before we do the panel, I just want to remind everyone watching at home, all the huge amounts of money you're talking about are not yours. You need money in order to free up this money. And I'm slightly banging the drum, but I need to, because we're talking about huge expansion and massive grants. Tell me something, if we've got a moment. You mentioned at some point there are other countries who are interested, or you think might be interested if you lobby them, in given the new reality on the ground in the Middle East and some of the new peace agreements, you feel like you can free up money from other countries. Is that right?
Absolutely. I mean, the government of the United Kingdom has officially endorsed the concept. The minister has now pledged that he will begin negotiations with the incoming Biden administration in January. Huda and I had very promising conversations at the Elysee in Paris with advisors to President Macron. And then we've had very senior conversations with Germany, with the European Union, with the Netherlands, and then other countries like Australia and Japan. We've been waiting for the moment that we appear to be at right now in Washington, where this law is enacted. And then it's a flashing green light for us as advocates to get out on the road and get those promising conversations that are ripe to the point where commitments are being made and this institutionalized multinational body is being created that can look at a 20-year time horizon and finance the sort of programs you're learning about tonight in a way that will allow them to scale to 10, 15, 20 times their current level. And for that, as you keep banging on,
you
need private philanthropic support. Right.
And when people give you this money, you're not flying first class.
I have never flown first class in my life.
Excellent.
Economy.
I want to picture you staying in very grubby hotels.
I could show you some plastic sheets in hotels in Tel Aviv and the Gulf as well.
All right. Well, I'm late again, so get off the screen and let's talk to some of these people doing extraordinary work in the education field. Because Israeli schools, of course, and schools across the region, not just divided along Arab-Israeli lines, inside Israel, they're divided along religious lines, but we have a chance to get in early, and certainly with the expansion of the program. Is it the Jesuits to say, give me the child before they're seven, I'll show you the man? This is the place where you can plant the seeds properly. I was told There's certainly a narrative that I was told and absorbed when I was young that I've had to unshake and see things a different way. I wish that I'd been educated the way some of the kids we're going to learn about in a minute are being educated. We need to scale it up. So first, let's talk to Mohammed Darwashi of Kibat Khaviva. You're the only, I think the only person I'm speaking to that has a physical presence in Israel. Just, again, I want to contextualize it. Given the reality in Israel, that, you know, for most people and across the region, how do you work against the grain there? How do you deal with the fact what they're finding at home and in the rest of their communities? And how can you scale that up?
Well, thank you, Jason, for having me. I mean, as you mentioned, Givat Haviva is probably the only organization with a campus. We have a 40-acre campus that we got donated by the kibbutz movement already in 1963. That's when we founded the first peace education institute in Israel that already won the UNESCO Prize for Peace Education. And since then, we've been seeing many initiatives and training many of the top professionals in this field. We actually use three different educational theories, what we call the social contact theory, the narrative debate theory, and the mutual interest theory. The focus is to work in three fields, in education, in creating partnerships, and in empowerment. So just to answer your question, Jason, in education, we bring about 5,000 Jewish and Arab kids every year, depends on funding. Sometimes we go up to 10,000, but our staff knows how to handle 50,000. Our facility can handle 50,000. Just there, we can do at least 10 times more encounters between Jewish and Arab youth, that this is their first encounter ever in their life. And from evaluation, we know that it works and it lasts.
If we what talk does that about mean it works? Sorry to interrupt. What does that mean it works? What do you see working?
It means that we're able to touch their hearts and minds. We're able to, maybe we're not bringing peace, but we're bringing pieces of peace. We're able to change perspectives, challenge stereotypes, reduce animosity. And we can measure this in short term, midterm, and long term. We know that our work sinks in the back of their heads, in the back of their minds, and they become better civic engagers. They engage with the other much better. They are able to see the humanity in the other side. They're able to agree and disagree with the other side. They're able to focus and look for creating shared space, whether it is being polite to each other or also being able to live in the same apartment building or be able to criticize the same government or work in a shared project in a laboratory at a hospital or university. We try to pair Jewish and Arab municipalities, adjacent municipalities, to work with each other on joint interests, such as building in joint industrial zones, joint sports facilities, joint public parks. We work with 5 pairs right now. We can easily bring this up to 50 pairs. We know, we have the know-how. We've been practicing this for the last 6 years. We can work with 50 pairs, 50 Jewish towns, 50 Arab towns to identify a mutual interest and actually work on it. In addition, we have identified the need for the empowerment of the weaker party in this relationship, empowerment of the Arab kids. You know, in order to increase the percentage of Arab employees in the high tech, we identify 120 excellent Arab kids, 14 years old already when they are 14, and start giving them academic courses in computer science. By the time they are 18, they finish high school with 50% of their undergraduate degree and straight to the high-tech industry in Israel. We work with 120 kids every year. We can work with 1,200 kids every year. We know how
to do the work. I've got to cut you off, Mohammed, because otherwise I'll spend all the time talking to you. But thank you so much. And anybody wants to look into Gbowee, Khabib, obviously, they have a website and any of these organizations.
When you come next time, we're going to show you where we're
going. I'm dying to come. Listen, I'm dying to come meet all of you. But I've got to skip on. It's speed dating, after all. So thank you for that. And we're going to talk to Amnon Berry Sulitiano. Did I get that right?
That's right.
Thank you. Of the Abraham Initiative. So, Amnon, you work with young people in the state's educational system, but also adults, politicians, journalists. How do you bridge the gap between your vision of shared society, what you're teaching them, and the reality of the life that they encounter when they go home? How does that work?
Yeah, so Jason, as a policy organization, our job is to help the government to accept and implement programs that are designed to help Jews and Arabs to simply live together. And we have an effective way to do this convincing, which is to carry out projects and use them as examples. And perhaps the most exciting idea that we're trying to push now is related to the segregation between the education systems in Israel. And in order to erode this segregation, we offer pairs of Jewish and Arab schools to study just one subject together as a beginning, each week at the other school. And this idea, which is called shared education, was imported to Israel from Northern Ireland. It was tested successfully there, and now we want to prove that in Israel it can be as effective in changing the hearts and minds, and in order to for our Ministry of Education to adopt it as its policy.
And the Ministry of Education at the moment is backing you, allows you to do it. Some of this is state endorsed.
So, yeah, normally most of our projects are done with the government, with the Ministry of Education. And the assumption is that once we prove the value of the program, it will be adopted. And this is why it is so critically important for us to expand those programs and to make, you know, to make the argument, the case that they actually work.
Fantastic. I'm going to skip on. That sounds amazing. I have to say, I did not imagine that the government would be backing schemes like this. So that's chipping away another brick of the wall of my cynicism. So thank you for that. And now Danny Elazar, CEO of the Hand in Hand Schools Network. Danny, how does a kindergarten to matriculation, which is an entire school, joint Jewish Arab education system, how does it change the life of its students, considering how different that is? It's roughly the same question. When they get home, the community they're surrounded by, the attitudes they're surrounded by, and how does it change the teachers and the parents? What do they do when they get home? How do they incorporate that into their life?
So good evening, Jason, and thanks for the question. Great to be here with you. You know, I'll tell you, I grew up in Israel in Jewish schools with only Jewish friends. And the only times I met Arabs were when I read about them in books or watched movies, and they were always the enemy. This is how most Israeli kids still grow up in Israel today, separately. And Hand in Hand is here in order to change that, to make a change. So within this separated system, we're a bilingual, multicultural network of schools and communities that bring together Jews and Arabs, kids and families, on a daily basis. I mean, they're all the time together. They're living together in better times and in worse times, in order to bring a message of hope and equality. They're playing, they're studying, they're involved in deep discussions together in both languages. You know, when you walk into our schools, you see an optimistic future picture of how Israel could be.
So both languages, you mean you teach the, you're teaching the Arab kids Hebrew and you're teaching the Israeli kids Arabic?
Right. So we have seven schools that are spread across the country with 2,100 students who speak both languages, and 10,000 community members who are all innovative bridge builders between both societies.
You ready for some money? Could you make it 70? Could you make it 70 schools? Are you ready for some money?
Of course. Our goal is to at least, we want to at least double the number of schools and even more than that. So every family will have that opportunity to live, to study together, to have that alternative for every family that is interested in shared education in every mixed city or region. If we do that, we can become a model and a beacon for the wider community, city, and country in order to promote a shared society, equal society in Israel. That's what we're aiming to. And the more money we have, the more schools we can open, the more we can reach that that goal.
We can help create the next generation that will not screw up as badly as we did. thanks very much, Danny.
Thank
now,
you.
Erez Bar from A New Way. Erez, you work inside the Israeli school system, which is a slightly different system. Your program is slightly different. You bring outsiders in. I say outsiders. You bring Arabs, presumably, into Israeli schools. Are they accepted? How does that work? What kind of resistance is there, and what effect do you see from it?
Hey, Jason. Thanks for having me here today. A New Way work at the formal educational system in Israel. I don't know if everybody knows that our formal educational system is formally divided. This means that Jews and Arabs rarely have any chance to work together or meet while they're growing up. A New Way actually allowing them to do so. We are praying together schools and communities and bringing them together as one force to meet and collaborate together. We do that using a multi-community-wide approach. This means that we work simultaneously, both in schools and outside schools. In schools, we work with teachers with parents and with the students themselves. And outside schools, we work with the community leaders, municipal staff, and mayors. Our evaluation showed that working with all of them simultaneously is highly increasing our impact. Furthermore, a new way uses a unique educational approach. We bring the informal into the formal system. We emphasizing that learning should be from one's own self-experience. This is one of the reasons that most of our facilitators come from the world of arts. As you know, theater actors, musicians, and artists bring unique set of tools. Those set of tools help them to break down the ice and create the experiences needed in order to create change, changing opinion and changing behaviors. And those two are fundamental in order to create multicultural collaboration and peace building.
Fantastic. Thank you, Eris. Let's hear it for the arts. I'm sorry, I'm getting the wind up thing again, even though I haven't spoken to everybody. So thank you for that, Eris. And finally, Mirvat Alaze from Merchavim. So I might have misread the brief. This, your organization is the one that brings in Arab and Palestinian teachers to schools with Israeli kids. Am I right?
Yes, we basically help in recruiting and placing Arab teachers in Jewish schools, supporting them and their principals, and providing them professional developing opportunities. Our research.
And what happens when they come in there? Do they face resistance? Are people welcoming? How does it play out?
Well, sometimes
don't paint a pretty picture. Tell us the truth.
Yes, sometimes they do. Sometimes they face some problems, but we are there to help. And they make a big change because beyond being math, science, sports, English, or homeroom teachers, our teachers in Jewish school affect pupils and they become their role models. They expose them to their culture, traditions, holidays. And they basically become agents of change who can positively change attitudes of the colleagues, students, and shift negative stereotypes and misconceptions about Arabs in general.
Right, and they're not teaching about the conflict. They're teaching subjects, as you can maths.
Yes, they teach subjects, but they break by their presence. They break the barriers, different barriers.
I'm sure. Thanks very much. That's all. Unfortunately, that's all we have time for. Anybody again who wants to look up any of these organizations, anyone who's traveling to the Middle East, should get in contact with them and see what they do on the ground. I can't wait to go and see what they do. But I think you get a sense of the work, anyone watching, you get a sense of the work, the innovation that's happening to radically alter the experience of young people and find some middle point between their competing narratives. But it's not happening enough to enough people. What they're doing is extraordinary. It will happen to more people, hopefully, with some of this money comes through from Congress. With the money that ALLMEP can raise from various countries who have expressed an interest, it could happen to millions of kids across the region. And imagine the difference that would make for peace in the future and how different their experience would be from their parents and grandparents. And it's in your hands. Actually, it's in your wallet. So if you could reach out now and give some money, that would be fantastic. Don't miss anything, but you'll be able to watch the recording later. Take the time to donate. Right now, thank you, everybody. I want to hand over to the UK's Shadow Foreign Secretary, Lisa Nandy. ALLMEP's campaign for the fund has drawn support from everywhere across the world, but Republicans and Democrats in America and cross-party, the Tories and Labour Party in Britain. It's extraordinary, frankly. There are very few issues that do that, and this is the one, and Lisa Nandy has been particularly vocal and rather fabulous about it, and now she's going to tell you in person. So, Lisa Nandy.
2020 has been a difficult year and one that has reminded us of the importance of common purpose. When I first visited the West Bank several years ago, the thing that gave me most hope was the mums that I met, Israelis and Palestinians, who'd come together to support one another in the military courts in the hardest of circumstances. That's how I know that the work that the Alliance for Middle East Peace does is so important, in building that shared empathy, understanding and sense of common purpose and bringing people together through programmes like the International Fund in order to build a common vision of the future. This has been a particularly difficult year for many Palestinians and for all those Palestinians and Israelis who still share the prospect of a peaceful two-state solution in the Middle East. But the suspension of annexation plans and the resumption of cooperation between Israel and Palestine in the last month should give us grounds for hope and the belief that through the work of important organisations like the Alliance for Middle East Peace, we can build that sense of common purpose and shared understanding and bring people together who believe in that vision for the future. In the end, that is the only way in which we're going to make it a reality.
Well, that's appalling. I mean, she was fantastic. I'm appalling. I missed out one of our key contributors to the panel, and her daughter is already calling her to ask what happened. So please, Gail Mossensen from Ain Bustan, tell us. You start Arab-Jewish educational work very, very young, three or four, I think. How does that work? First of all, do you see the fruits of that? Does it work? Is it worth the bother? They're so young. How does it impact? And I'm so sorry.
It's all right. It's definitely worth the bother. We all know the importance of early childhood education. We can't stress it enough. It's the ages we're most open to the world. Now, in Ain Bustan, we start at the age of one, actually. We're a community-based Jewish-Arab nonprofit organization for social change, and we basically run a Waldorf bilingual multicultural nursery and kindergarten. And kids from ages 1 to 7 from the neighboring Jewish and Arabic communities. Basically, we have a vision to live together in equality, peace, and mutual understanding. And we provide this opportunity through the young children of both people. They come together on a daily basis, getting to know one another, respect, and interact from an early age. And they have—
Do you have follow-up data? Have you been going long enough to see whether they stay in touch?
They do stay in touch. And we can see basically the sharing of these cultures and languages from an early age with a bilingual curriculum brings also the families together. And the kids meet in the afternoon, their families meet in the afternoon, and this friendship and love that they develop with the other children, the staff, the other families, it helps them keep an open heart in the future for future encounters with people who are other or different than themselves. And we can see how these families stay in touch and the children.
Sorry, are you ready to expand? Could you do it? If there's somebody tomorrow morning said, can you scale up 10 times, could you do it?
I don't know about 10 times, but most definitely we want to expand our nursery for more nurseries, more kindergartens, and we definitely want to grow into a school.
Fantastic. Thank you, Gail. And I'm sorry again, I forgot you. I'm too vain to wear my glasses on camera, and I missed the paragraph. Meanwhile, back to the original program. Oh, is the original program me? No.
It's my utmost honor to introduce to you one of my heroes in the peace building field, an amazing woman from Liberia, a peace activist, a women's rights advocate, a 2011 Nobel Peace Laureate, Leymah Gbowee. She's joining us through this pre-recorded panel with an outstanding fellow women from Palestine and Israel to answer the question, why women should be leading peace-building world.
Hi, everyone. My name is Leymah Roberta Gbowee. I'm a Liberian peace activist, a women's rights advocate, 2011 Nobel Peace Prize winner. It has been said that the impact of conflict on women's lives is a reflection of the interaction during peacetime. What do you all think women between Israel and Palestine can bring to the peace table in this 21st century, in COVID era, or even post-COVID era? What can you bring that can transform this whole peace process from talk shop into actual action? And I'll start with, let me start with Naveen.
As women, as individuals, taking everything that we hear back from our communities, but also taking that message forward to decision makers and different leaders as well. And the other strategy would be our ability to come together and organize. There are so many issues that hold us together as a community. Whether we are Palestinian or Israeli, we both felt loss. We both have so many things in common. But the thing is, how do we start recognizing each other's experience and building on that experience and narratives towards one movement that can put pressure on decision makers and come up with our own initiative to peace.
With this virus. We found amazing opportunities as feminists to collaborate and forgetting about all, you know, not forgetting, but we can pause, you know, lots of things that keep us from collaboration before. And we did manage to build coalitions, demonstrations, movements, statements, and to work together.
You know, this moment of truth when we say to ourselves, are we serious about this? Are we, you know, committed to this with all our might? And for me, this was yes, yes. And in my experience as a Jewish Israeli who's been doing anti-occupation and peace work for, I don't know, 40 years almost, there's the elephant in the room, which is the occupation. It's the elephant in the feminist room. We're able to collaborate around gender-based violence and pain equity and health and many other issues. But there comes a point where we hit this huge elephant in the room. And the only way that we can remove the elephant from the room is to acknowledge that it's there.
When I look at this question, what women bring to the table and peace processes, I think, first of all, women bring courage. When a woman, and especially in a militarized society like Israel and Palestine, stand up to talk about peace or security, the amount of objection, attack, obstacles she faces is enormous. And yet, so many women do. Second, I think women bring care. Most of the women I met in the course of my work over the years acted because they care, not for jobs, not for money, not for power, but genuinely to make their society a better place. So we can very easily see that without women, there will be no peace.
Let me take from you, Nita.
I believe and I think that community, the power of group, the power of community, the solidarity that we can build together as a feminist woman is the basic for making a change. We will understand that we have the same problem. Then we can build the power of being together and making a change together. It will start from the basic of the daily life, and then we can take it for the peace process. It's important, and not losing the hope in our way.
So as a indigenous Palestinian woman who grew up in one of the unrecognized villages of the Negev, lacking water, electricity, and basic needs, and spending the first 12 years of her life as a shepherd to make a living for her family, and then do all this activism for the last 25 years, I come up with these four lessons learned about us women. We have to understand that we don't have to agree on 100%. We will never agree on 100%. And if we wait for that, there is no solution for any crisis. If we have 60%, 70%, let's get together and work in this 60%. And believe me, the differences will take care of themselves when we are in the process. The second thing is that just doing ground up power building is not enough. We need to change the structural aspects of this conflict.
When I bring Palestinian women from Gaza, from East Jerusalem, from Israel, we place them with congressional women like Congresswoman AOC or Ilhan Omar. And I remember my girls like in tears thinking, they care, like people care about my story. And I always have to remind them, our personal stories is the political conversation. Our personal stories is the political power that we have. When I go and I speak, people listen because it's real and it's passionate. And with this peace building movement, I look around and I do see that the organizations are majority run by men. And I just think to myself, we need to criticize ourselves openly. And think like, who is leading us and why aren't there enough women in it? So Leymah, I think I'll end with, how can we as a vision just achieve the ordinary joys of life, of walking to school without an army or mandatory service, the ordinary life of building a home without being demolished? That's what I want to get, an ordinary life, so that every girl and woman in Palestine and Israel can dream extraordinary goals.
So to Huda, and then I'll wrap up. Huda, what is the ALLMEP vision for peace between Israel and Palestine?
Thank you, Leymah. It's a huge question, and this is why the Alliance for Middle East Peace is doing this work, because we believe in inclusivity. We don't necessarily think that only women can bring peace, but we for sure want to push for more women in the peace building arena. And we want women to speak their truth, and we want them to raise their capacity to be able to lead the movement in Palestine and in Israel. And as the Alliance for Middle East Peace and as the regional director who worked with these wonderful women on many levels, I promise you that this is going to be the strategy for the Alliance for Middle East Peace, building the capacity of peace builders in Palestine and Israel in order to change the dynamics of the conflict. And I promise that it will be led by women, because we already are doing it.
I promise that it will be led by women. Our connection, our collective humanity, development, justice, the future generation. These are all visions that we have for peace in Israel and in Palestine. Coming together as women, and not letting it be about one region or one city, but what touched one woman touched us all. When one bomb drops in Tel Aviv and another drops in Gaza, it touches the core of all of us. Peace is not just about ending the war. It is about our collective humanity.
That was such a fantastic panel. A huge thank you to Sivan Saperstein of ALLMEP for editing down what was a 30-minute conversation to around 8 or 9 minutes of highlights. But if you want to watch the full discussion led by Leymah Gbowee, the Nobel Peace Laureate who helped to end the civil war in Liberia, please check out our YouTube channel, where we'll post the video later this week. And again, a big thank you to Leymah, not only for speaking to us tonight, but for speaking to all of our members and leading them in a march only a few years ago in Jerusalem and helping to build one of the largest women's movements for peace in the Middle East. Now, again, just as an update of where we stand on our match drive this evening, as you'll see, we have nearly $390,000 donated, which is extraordinary. And thank you so much to everybody who's already given. We still have around $50,000 of match funding available. So please give what you can. If you can, encourage other people in your network who care about peace building in the Middle East to do the same thing. And I want you to just think for a second about the relationship between these incredible, innovative leaders for peace you're seeing in civil society and the broken politics we see in both Israel and Palestine at the elite level. These aren't two completely parallel tracks. They're totally linked. One is an engine that informs and populates the other with the new leaders for the future. If we invest at that grassroots level, if we create these leaders emerging from the bottom up, these younger people who are passionate, who know each other and are willing to dedicate their lives towards peace, then if we have patience and if this work is resourced sufficiently, you will see the politics transform downstream from that. Now, we're very lucky to be joined by two politicians in the United States who understand that relationship between the grassroots and the grass tops, for want of a better phrase. And there are also two members of the US Senate who have been amongst the most steadfast leaders for the International Fund, and also two great supporters of Middle East peace more generally. I'm really pleased to introduce and welcome, and I'm so grateful for their presence, to have Senate Minority Leader Chuck Schumer and Senator Coons joining us now for A Shine of Light. Thank you so much.
Hi, everyone. This is Senator Chuck Schumer, and I'm honored to join the Alliance for Middle East Peace at tonight's virtual gathering. This has been an unprecedented year, and I want to thank all of you and all of your partner organizations for continuing your peace-building mission, even in the face of such adversity. Since 2006, you've been a force for good in the region, and your focus on people-to-people initiatives, programs like Seeds of Peace, Hand in Hand, have transformed the lives of countless Israelis and Palestinians. We must invest in bringing together the next generation of Israelis and Palestinians in mutual cooperation and respect. And that's why I support the work you do and will fight for legislation to advance your mission. And that's why I'm also proud to support legislation like the Nita M. Lowey Middle East Partnership for Peace Act, which would fund peace-building programs between Israelis and Palestinians. Congressman Lowey has been a great champion of people-to-people programs, and boy, will I miss her in the Congress. Thankfully, she and you have helped build strong bipartisan support all around Congress. This legislation and things like it will continue long after she is retired. Finally, I look forward to the day when we can finally see each other in person and put this awful disease behind us once and for all. So thank you all for the honor of addressing you tonight. Stay safe and God bless.
Hi, I'm U.S. Senator Chris Coons from Delaware, a member of the Senate Foreign Relations Committee and of the Appropriations Subcommittee that funds USAID in our overseas development work. I'm honored to join the Alliance for Middle East Peace at tonight's gala. Tonight, we celebrate the work of peacemakers across the globe, those striving for a safer and more prosperous world, and in particular, those working to bring peace and reconciliation between Israelis and Palestinians. As this community knows all too well, sustainable peace isn't achieved by governments. It's cultivated and built up by the everyday people around the world in areas of conflict from the ground up. So I'm proud that the Partnership Fund for Peace Act is an important tool to help us work together towards this goal. This bill will foster peace by strengthening connections between communities through economic cooperation and reconciliation efforts that will help Israelis and Palestinians build relationships to bring about genuine peace. I thank, of course, Chairman Lindsey Graham of the State and Foreign Operations Subcommittee, my partner in this legislation in the Senate, and all of the bill's supporters, including all of you. We are very close to getting this bill over the finish line, and that wouldn't have been possible without ALLMEP's support. I am, of course, also grateful to Chairwoman Nita Lowey of New York. Her legacy of championing Middle East peace and her tireless efforts about advancing this Palestinian Fund for Peace Act. So thank you to all at this evening's event for hosting this inaugural gala to support efforts towards lasting peace. Thank you and enjoy the evening.
Thank you so much, Senator Coons, and also Senator Schumer, for your leadership and for all you've done to advance the Middle East Partnership for Peace Act. Now, as you may have noticed, we're running a little bit behind schedule, but I urge you to stick with us. When you get Israelis and Palestinians together talking peace, things sometimes run a little bit over schedule, but you're not going to find a conversation like this anywhere else on the internet today. And this next panel is fascinating. The year that we've just had with the pandemic really teaching us how interconnected we all are, as well as the emergency with climate change that shows how the whole world is interconnected and our fates are very much joined together, I think has created a new resonance that some of our members in the field were early adopters of before. The field of health and environment within ALLMEP's membership is where some of the most pioneering, innovative work is being done, not just between Israelis and Palestinians, but actually across the wider Middle East as well. And for this panel and for this discussion, we're delighted to be joined by the comedian Maz Jobrani. Now, people may know Maz from his Axis of Evil comedy tour or his appearance on many US talk shows where he satirizes the sometimes bizarre way that the Middle East is addressed in the West. Maz, thank you so much for joining us. It's really a privilege.
Thank you for having me, John. It's been a privilege to watch you guys. And I got to say, Jason, you're doing a fantastic job. Even though you missed the other lady, don't worry about it. I know the thing with the glasses. Jason, I didn't know I was, by the way, for anybody on here, I'm a comedian, so please don't get offended at anything I say. But Jason, I didn't know I was losing my sight until I was trying to lose weight to slim down. And I went to the gym and they had one of those scales where you got to read the numbers. It's not the electronic scale. And I was trying to read the number and I was having difficulty reading. And then I go, oh my God, I'm worried about getting fat. I'm going blind. So I know how that goes, my friend. And John, thank you for having me, my friend. This is amazing. First of all, you guys are doing a fantastic job. I could listen to your and Jason's British accents all day long. You brought on an American accent, so what am I going to do? To my Arab friends on here, yalla, yalla, habibi, habibi, yalla, wallahi, wallahi. That's all the words I know after 10 years of going to the Middle East. To my Jewish friends, happy Hanukkah. To my non-Arab, non-Jewish friends, happy Tuesday. Here's the thing, by the way, Alliance for Middle East Peace. John, I'm hoping that one day we will have peace and ALLMEP will become past tense. So it'll be ALLMEPed. You just add an ED and the organization keeps going. You understand what I'm saying? You got the, okay. Listen, I hope you guys are all staying safe and sane under the lockdown. I'm a stand-up comedian. I got into stand-up comedy to not have a desk job. Now I'm sitting at a desk telling jokes. What's going on here? This is the craziest year ever. Am I right or am I right? I used to have a family. You guys know anybody who has a family. I live in Los Angeles. Everyone's on lockdown. My kids are studying on Zoom. My wife is working on Zoom. I used to have a family. Now I go in the living room and there's a different person in every corner of the room on a computer. We look like an internet startup company. We're just looking for some venture capitalist funding and we'll be good to go. So anyway, John was kind enough to invite me to come be a part of this very serious conversation where very serious people are doing amazing things. And he said, Maz, tell some jokes and you have a minute to do it. This is my life. What am I going to do? All right. Listen, I'm going to keep the event moving. It's nighttime there. It's daytime here. I'm also Middle Eastern. I was born in Iran. So we're used to starting late, so it's okay, or going late, I should say. So it's okay, we're running a little late. Where do you have to go? Everyone's on lockdown. You got nowhere to go. Just sit there and keep watching this and donate. Come on, what do you have to, you don't have anything to pay for. There's no gas or flights, or you just put your money towards this. Come on. All right. This section is going to be done differently. Jason's been very eloquent in talking to people. And I'm a comedian. We don't talk to people. We talk at people. So I figured what I'll do is I'll introduce everybody and they're going to go ahead and talk about what they're doing. This is the environment and health section of the event. And I'm just going to run down the name of the speakers you're going to see right now, and then I'll come back at the end. So you're going to be hearing from Gideon Bromberg, co-founder and Israeli director, Eco Peace Middle East Environment. You're going to be hearing from Shira Krontich, of strategy and operations manager, Track 2 Environmental Forum, Arava Institute for Environmental Studies. You're going to be hearing from Kenneth Bob, board member, Project Rosanna. You're going to hear from Dr. Akram Amro, CEO, Greenland Society. And you're going to hear from Yara Abu Arkub, Road to Recovery. So we're going to go ahead and get started with the first speaker. Please welcome right now, Gideon Bromberg.
Maz, thank you so much for that introduction. What a wonderful evening it's been. So shalom and salam from Tel Aviv. Eco Peace. As the name suggests, is environment and peace building. And what's unique about us is that we're Israelis, Palestinians, Jordanians working together from our offices in Tel Aviv, in Ramallah, and in Amman. And what we're so excited about in the creation of the fund is scaling up, because the environment is all about scaling up impact. And we currently work with youth, with school kids, with young professionals. About 7,000 young people are impacted, learning about their environment, their scarce water reality, and their neighbor's scarce water reality presently. With a fund, we can increase that 100-fold. With the creation of the fund, the policy work that we undertake currently focuses on bringing more water into every Palestinian home, into every Jordanian home, in trying to clean up the sewage and the pollution that crosses and pollutes our scarce water resources. So with the creation of the fund, we can see more water flowing into every home in the region. We can see the potential of cleaning up the pollution that's currently poisoning our shared environment. So we're excited about this work. We can do so much more, and we can change the reality on the ground by focusing on our shared environment. Let me pass on the microphone to Shira.
Thank you. I'm very happy and excited to be here. The ALLMEP Institute for Environmental Studies is a leading environmental study and research institute in the Middle East.
with a student body comprised of Jordanians, Palestinians, Israelis, and participants from around the world, the Araba offers students a unique opportunity to learn from leading environmental professionals while living together and forming networks and friendships and developing skills that enable them to lead the region to a new reality and collaboratively solve today's most pressing environmental challenges. Alumni are our most important asset. We're incredibly proud of our alumni who remain connected to the Institute and to each other long after their time living together here at the Araba. Our alumni see communities and basins where people's lives are dependent on one on another. They see the region as a whole, one large ecosystem, where the human potential can only be achieved through cross-border cooperation. One example of this unique perspective is the recent establishment of the Young Professionals Forum, YPF, which includes alumni, but is not limited to only them. We, the YPF, are a group of young professionals from across the Middle East committed to a new vision for the region. We believe in a future where the region is more integrated and is based on the values of equality, freedom, and justice. We wish to increase the ability to interact by creating new spaces of knowledge and ideas sharing. We wish to create mutually beneficial interaction based on open discussion, open minds, respect, and solidarity. Through shared and common understanding, hands-on projects and advocacy, we wish to become a model for a more integrated region and to form the foundations necessary for new regional structures and coalition. I'm now happy to pass it on to Ken Bob.
Thank you, Shira. At Project Rosanna, we have found that healthcare is successful in building bridges of understanding between Israelis and Palestinians. And it's a place in civil society where large numbers of people can meet every day in an atmosphere of mutual respect. And since access to good medical treatment is considered a human right, people of goodwill will try to overcome conflict-related obstacles to make it happen. To exploit this opportunity, Project Rosanna supports the training of Palestinian healthcare workers in Israeli medical institutions, the transportation of Palestinian patients from their homes in West Bank and in Gaza to their appointments at Israeli hospitals, and funding gaps in their treatment. With strong partnerships in place on the ground in Palestine and Israel, additional funding will allow us to significantly increase all aspects of these programs. Now, the COVID-19 pandemic has emphasized what we all already know, and that is that a health crisis doesn't stop at the Green Line or military checkpoints. So even during these tense political times, the Israeli government, Palestinian Authority, the World Health Organization, civil society have all supported our Project Rosanna efforts to get the necessary equipment, materials, and training to Palestinian hospitals in order to treat infected patients. In this way, and together with our grantees, two of whom you're going to hear from next, we can accomplish our dual goals, building strong, lasting relationships between Israelis and Palestinians and improving healthcare outcomes for the Palestinian community. And with that, I pass it over to my friend and colleague, Dr. Akram Amro.
Thank you, Ken, and good evening, everyone. It's a pleasure being here. So Greenland Society of Health Development is a nonprofit organization that was established in 2007 with the aim of improving quality of life for Palestinians through contribution to better environment and health. We do that through education and awareness, and for that, we have established the first of its kind in region environmental and educational center. We do partnership with the regional and local universities and hospitals in conducting and publishing of several research that we have managed to publish in prestigious international journals. And in the health sector, we have been honored by running since more than 3 years a Nobel project, which was called Wheels of Hope, that is transporting Palestinian patients treated in Israeli hospitals to and from the checkpoints. And the second half of the trip is conducted by several other Israeli organizations that you will hear Yara later elaborate on that. In addition to that, we've been working on building building the resilience and increasing the resilience and preparedness in the area of emergency disaster management through the establishment and training of local emergency response teams. And on top of that, we've been working for more than 13 years in the field of capacity building, concentrating on upgrading and training allied health professionals through short courses and training programs, and helping distinguished students to get accepted for postgraduate graduate positions and scholarships in regional universities. By getting more funding, we hope that we can augment our abilities to achieve our goals and have more chance to serve the region. And being a new member of ALLMEP, we're also looking forward for further networking and to advocate for our vision for a better future of the region. Thank you. And then I pass over to the brilliant Yara. Yara.
Thank you, Dr. Akram. I'm going to be talking about mine and my family's experience with Road to Recovery, and an organization that provides transportation to Palestinian patients from different territories to Israeli hospital. My brother, Iyas, is a 13-year-old boy diagnosed with osteogenesis imperfecta and has been receiving treatment at different hospitals for the past 13 years of his life, mainly at Israeli hospitals. For the past few years, we've been receiving help from Road to Recovery with transportation. And usually our trips to the hospital would be filled with stress, anxiety, and worry. But with Road to Recovery, it became about meeting someone for the first time from the other side, getting to know them, and having a good conversation about the things we have in common, our activities, and our future plans. So the trip would end up with a new friend and a new plan to go back home with the same person. What makes Road to Recovery so special is that they focused on the good that people can do for each other instead of the conflict, and they put human values and human connection and health first, which is why they've succeeded at making such good connections and building bridges between the two people. I'm going to hand it back to you now, Maz. Thank you. Haven't seen you since Paris. Hope you're doing well.
Thank you, Yara. Thank you to all the speakers. It's you guys are very inspirational, all of you. So thank you so much, Yara. I want to thank all of our speakers for that segment, the environment and health segment. You guys, please, as you're watching this, do continue to give. And I believe now, so you have seen a lot of activists, and now I have been a comedian. Now we're going to combine activist with comedian and bring on someone who's a friend of mine, who is living in Israel, and she's a stand-up comedian. I got a chance to meet her, and I would like to bring up, if we can, Noam Shuster. Can we bring Noam up? Is that possible? I'm looking at this. Where is Noam? There she is. Hi, Noam. How are you?
Maz, what do you mean you know me? You're a friend of mine.
I'm sorry. I was looking because it was funny because they stayed on Yara, and so I got confused with the technical issues. I love Noam. Noam. So let me just tell the story. Noam contacted me a couple years ago. She came to Harvard to do a show about Israelis and the Palestinians and getting together, coexistence. I'll let you talk about that yourself. However, when I met her. Was that only a year ago we met? Was it a year and a half ago?
Yeah, like a year and a half ago.
When it was a different world. We met, she came on my shows in Boston. She came to my show in DC. She's performed, she's fantastic. I've agreed to help her produce the show eventually, and then lockdown. So now we're on Zoom. How are you, Noam?
Maz, the second best thing that happened to me after performing with you in the US is that I got COVID, and then I got famous, because the best thing a comedian can ask for in 2020 is to get COVID.
Hey, and whatever it takes, Noam, if it's good for the career, you got to do it.
Whatever it takes. But Maz, I'm super excited to be in this event and to see you. You're a great inspiration of mine. You're the first Iranian comedian that I saw on the big screen in big America. And, you know, me being obsessed with my Iranian Jewish roots, I was like, Maz, if Maz can do it, I can do it. And performing with you in the US is such a big dream. I hope I get to come back if things ever open.
I think we're going to get there. We have changes are happening here and the vaccine is out. And so we can see each other. I don't know if I'm going to shake your hand yet. I'm still doing namaste. I'm going to hug you.
Yeah, but you know, I have antibodies and I'm all immune and everything. So yeah. But I'm so excited to be part of this event. And I'm also super worried because this event is going so well. And I know that a lot of funds have been raised. So I just want to tell everyone, slow down. We're not trying to solve the conflict so quickly and raise a lot of funds. I need materials for my comedy, you guys. Excuse you. Don't be too amazing tonight. I'm here to remind everyone that we have lots of problems that we need to solve. For those of you who don't know me, my name is Noam Schuster. Don't confuse me with Noam Chomsky, because everywhere I go in the US, I have to say that you can call me Chomsky if you can't pronounce Noam. Up until 3 years ago, I was working for the UN in a big peace building mission, and I was only an activist. And three-something years ago, I started telling jokes in Hebrew, Arabic, and English, and it's been going very, very well. I'm getting into lots of trouble. I feel very, very close to ALLMEP in my heart because I actually grew up in a community called Neve Shalom in Hebrew, Wahat Salam in Arabic, the Oasis of Peace in English. It's the only place where hippie Jews and hippie Palestinians live together by choice. So that's where I grew up. I grew up speaking Hebrew and Arabic, and my parents are, they're not perfect. They're leftists. Not all parents are perfect. I'm actually, my Jewish heritage is mixed. So my father is a Romanian Ashkenazi Jew, and he's blonde, green eyes. He looks like a Swedish sperm donor next to me. And my mom is an Iranian Jew. She was born in Iran, have a big, big Persian family. And when I was 7 years old, my parents moved to Neve Shalom, Wahat Salam. And this is where I was raised, with both languages, both cultures, both narratives. At the age of seven, Israeli Independence Day is no longer just Israeli Independence Day. I'm also learning and acknowledging the Palestinian narrative and the narrative of my best friend. And I grow up in the midst of this coexistence community, right? And you know, the stereotype about the peace community is that most of the Jews are Ashkenazi, European looking. And me, I look like Ahmadinejad a little bit, let's face it. And so when I learned Arabic really, really well, my identity crisis is that everyone thought I was Palestinian because I look Middle Eastern. And then all my Palestinian friends that I grew up with, like my best friend who's a Palestinian, her name is Ranin. She looks like Gigi Hadid, like Swedish top model. And every time we cross checkpoints, the soldiers, they stop my car. They look at her, they hit on her, they ask for her number, and then they look at me and they're like, give me your ID, please. So I grew up with all of these complexities, and doing comedy and writing jokes about it and working on my one woman show has been really a life savior. What I didn't expect is that Harvard University will give me a scholarship to come to the US and write a one woman comedy show. When I got this invitation, I thought it was a joke. So I said, if I come to Harvard, I will call my one-woman show Coexistence My Ass, you know, to make fun of everything, and I hit send. What I didn't expect is to get an email back after 10 days from Harvard saying, Dear Noam, Coexistence My Ass has been approved by Harvard. So a year ago, I was with Maz in the United States working on this one-woman show, and then, boom, COVID hit. And my emails became a cancellation festival. And I felt like God was looking at me and telling me, oh, you think you're going to talk about coexistence and peace between Israelis and Palestinians through comedy in the United States? You're cute, Noam, you're very cute. Come back home. And on my way back home on the airplane, I got this damn virus. And then I was quarantined and I was recovering in a Corona hotel in Jerusalem, where there were hundreds of people, Israelis and Palestinians, and everybody were getting along. And I was like, excuse me, nobody is getting along. I am developing a one-woman show about the conflict. Nobody is getting along. So I staged fights when I was in the hotel every day at 4 p.m. so that everyone can feel comfortable and at home. But on a serious note, because I need to end and we need to move on, in these 2 weeks when I was quarantined in the Corona hotel, I saw a glimpse of very extreme circumstances of solidarity and extreme compassion towards each other from people who were sick together in the hotel. I know that's not the reality outside. We still have lots of work to do. And I know we're facing inequality and injustice outside. But I want to remind everyone that the human tendency is to take care of each other. Our human tendency is to work for justice. Our human tendency is to realize that the well-being of Palestinians is the well-being of Jews, and our fates are intertwined and nobody is going anywhere. And so I really, 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 really thank you for the invitation. And I admire everyone for the work that we're doing, especially during those hard days. And I hope that we will see you soon in such exciting events. I have to finish. I have so many other things to say, but our time is up. And I want to hand it back to our lovely host, Jason Isaacs. Back to you.
Wow. That's all you ever want as a performer is to follow Tony Blair, then later on follow two brilliant comedians. It's ideal. Maz, by the way, I would swap my English accent for your magnificent teeth, or yours, Noam. Do all comedians have good teeth? Is that a prerequisite?
Only Iranian comedians. Sorry.
I have the cliched English teeth. Anyway, there we are. Back at the farm, and a quick change of tone. I recorded an interview last week with two of the board members. You've met some of the people who work for ALLMEP, and you met the people who work in the extraordinary organizations that they are in their umbrella. But I got to speak to some of the people who give of their time and their effort and their passion for free and ask them why. Why ALLMEP? And they have two very different experiences. It's Greg Rack and Mesa Baransi. Forgive me if I ask some of the questions in there, the answers to which you've heard already tonight, but you can take some solace in the fact we have no more than 3 or 4 hours left of this evening. So no, we're coming to a close. So you can put the kettle on and the microwave. You'll be eating soon. Here's a conversation I had with two of ALLMEP's board members earlier. So let me ask both of you, but start with Mesa.
Yes.
What got you involved? When did you get involved? And what does it mean to you to be involved with ALLMEP?
So I've been involved with ALLMEP from the beginning, from the starts of it. It was a tiny seed thinking of finding a foundation of all organization. We started with 12 organizations, and as you have heard, now we have grown to 125 organizations, wow. And it's still growing. But why am I here? As a Palestinian, every time we talk about the Middle East, often the images that come to your mind are those that you consume in your mainstream media. In short, it's a war zone, suicide bombing, terrorist attack, invasions to Gaza, etc., etc. However, for many years, we as Palestinians and peace builders, civil society organization, have been working meticulously. What ALLMEP has succeeded in doing is exposing everything we have been doing to the world. Our journey is still too long. And yet with ALLMEP, it is possible to channel our voices. So as a mother, I will always say, we speak for peace and we speak for justice. We speak for coexistence. We speak for a better future. As a Palestinian, I want my children to grow together, to know that our neighbors are our best friends and enjoy.
Do you feel hopeful? You feel hopeful in the medium and long term?
I cannot not be hopeful, Jason, and that's the reason I am here. I cannot just give up and let other voices be heard.
Great. Thank you. Greg, the same question. I think you're a more recent arrival to ALLMEP. Tell us why you got involved and what it means to you.
Well, I first went to Israel, Jason, when I was 16 on tour. And in fact, I think that's where I very first met you.
Possibly.
And I fell in love with Israel on tour. And I always say today that I live in the UK, but my heart is in Israel. I've only been with ALLMEP for a couple of months, but I've been involved with the conflict and working towards peace for the last 10 years. And I've worked with organizations that today ALLMEP supports. And I know firsthand how those organizations transform people's lives. I know ex-Hamasniks that are now peaceniks. And I know former right-wing Israelis that are now peace activists. And why ALLMEP? Because as an investor in the real estate market, which is what I do in London, I look for a return on investment. So why ALLMEP? Because it costs us about $1 million a year to run our organization. But we deliver $50 million a year to the organizations we support. So as an investor, I don't think there's any organization which can deliver a better return on investment.
Fantastic. Well, thank you, both of you. Keep doing it on behalf of those of us who are lazier. And let's hope that people tonight open their wallets and help you keep doing it at a bigger and bigger scale as the years go by.
Thank you, Jason.
Just before this last section and I get to say goodbye, I just want to say that my mum died in 2014 in Israel when the rockets were flying over from Gaza and into Gaza. But she devoted most of her life to service, to trying to do something, leave the world better than she found it. And I know how proud she would be of all the work that everyone is doing here. And I feel incredibly humbled and inspired. And I have to say, a shell of cynicism has fallen off me during this evening. I hope it has off everyone else. And if it has, do reach for your wallet and let's let ALLMEP free up funds for to expand all these incredible programs. So finally, we have something very special. We have two extraordinary people. Robbie Damnin is an Israeli mum who lost her son David in the Second Intifada, and she turned her grief into something positive, into activism with ALLMEP member, the Parents Circle, and Suli Khatib, a Palestinian, spent time in Israeli jail but turned away from violence and works with Israelis who did the same in Combatants for Peace. And together, their organizations hosted the joint memorial where Israelis and Palestinians gather together as equals and as allies. And last year, their ceremony had 200,000 global attendees, which makes it what the New York Times called the largest joint Israeli-Palestinian peace event in history. They are very model. They're the very personification of everything all of these organizations hope to achieve. So first, good night, everybody. Thank you. And over to you, Robbie.
Hi, thank you very much. And I really want to thank ALLMEP before I say anything, because you have made such a difference in the life of the Parents Circle and opened the most extraordinary doors. I lost my son, David, and then I was invited to all kinds of ceremonies, memorial ceremonies. And what they were sirens and 2 minutes of silence. And then there would be sad songs, and then there would be pontificating people giving speeches with that meant nothing to me. And I would come away sadder than when I went in. And then the Parents Circle and Combatants for Peace created a different kind of ceremony, a ceremony where you went in and you could listen to people tell their stories of loss, but also their stories of reconciliation and transformation and nonviolence. Where else could you hear something like that? Is it surprising that we had so many people? I don't think so. And I'm hoping that we will have 500,000 people this year. What was the equation that I came away with after the ceremony? The question is hope. And hope is the basic part of creating any future peace process. Thank you. Suli.
Thank you, Ruby. Good evening, everybody. Thanks, Jason and ALLMEP for this amazing gala. And after all the friends that spoke here, so I'm not gonna add a lot. Just to mention I'm speaking to you from Ramallah, and I'm from organization Joint Palestinian-Israeli Movement that adopted the joint nonviolent struggle to end the Israeli occupation and to make peace and freedom and dignity and human rights for all the people that live between the river and the sea. My background, as you mentioned briefly, I spent 10 years and 5 months in Israeli jails from the age of 14 and 5 months. And that's where I learned the great forces of nonviolence, which is the hardest choice than violence itself. And many of our members and founders actually from both sides, the Israelis used to serve in the Israeli army, officers in the Israeli army, and some Palestinians that founded the organization also were in jail, and activists and freedom fighters come to the conclusion that there is no military solution for our conflict. Of course, it takes a long, long journey to come to this conclusion. And definitely in Combatants for Peace and with some many other organizations that work together, it's really important to mention the power dynamic that exists here. And of course, as you mentioned, the ceremony, the memorial, the Palestinian-Israeli Memorial Day, when we started as Ruby, remember, like we had 70 people and 15 years ago. And then the next year we have 200 people and then 500 people. And before Corona, the last event, we had almost 10,000 people attending the ceremony until we, thanks for Corona, had 200,000 people last ceremony during the Corona using the internet. We also added in Combatants for Peace another important acknowledging event, which is the Palestinian Nakba ceremony. We did start that last year, and next year we expect also to hold the Nakba event together with our Israeli partners. It's very important for us to recognize the past. And as Ruby mentioned in her story, we have a lot of people that lost their beloved ones in the family. We have thousands of prisoners. We have a lot of suffering happening in this conflict. We recognize that, and we are not in competing who's suffering more and the victimhood, rather than we want to transform this pain and victimhood into positive towards each other. And this trauma and wound will heal once we acknowledge each other's existence. As Maisa said, or somebody before me, we're not going anywhere. We belong to this place. And together we can make this change. And we are cooperating with many organizations locally, internationally, and that's why ALLMEP has been a great force for supporting and building alliances and partnership among all these organizations that adopt different strategy. So I would say from trauma healing to spirituality to direct action that use some organization use against the a system in order to change the system for the liberation of our people that's totally connected in both sides. Thank you.
And for anybody who hasn't joined the joint memorial ceremony, it really is the most beautiful, poignant event. We would really like to see next year's one build even from the 200,000 people that joined last year's one. And we at ALLMEP are going to work hard to inspire our entire community, hopefully all of your communities, to join as well. It really, there's no event like it in the annual calendar. And it's a real moment for both Israelis and Palestinians to recognize so much of their shared identity and shared humanity. So I wanted to give a quick update in that we've had an extraordinary results and performance from you, from our incredible network of supporters around the world. This has really exceeded all of our expectations. Thank you so much to everybody who's given, genuinely. It's been awe-inspiring to watch this, to see people from literally all over the planet coming in and supporting this work. We have around $20,000 left of matched funding. It'd be amazing if we could hit that at some point before the end of the day. So if you haven't given already and you've hung in till now with us, please do consider making a gift and encouraging others to do so. I've been very lucky as the executive director of ALLMEP to build upon the foundations set by my predecessor, by Joel Brownold. And I want to really thank Joel for all that he has done, both for the advocacy for the Middle East Partnership for Peace Act, the kind of ideation of the International Fund, and really helping to frame and energize so much of the work that's going on in the region. We're hugely grateful, Joel, for your leadership. And I also wanted to thank and introduce, similarly, a person from our community who has really done more than anybody else in the diplomatic sphere. And that's UN Special Coordinator Nickolay, for the last 5 years, Nickolay, as well as negotiating ceasefires between Hamas and Israel on an almost bi-monthly basis, has ceaselessly platformed our members at pretty much every avenue you can imagine. The UN Security Council, in the corridors of power with other diplomats. I hear frequently from politicians from Europe and the United States, Nickolay bringing up the work of our community that you've seen today in his conversations with them. And he's also, only a few months ago, spent 3 hours on the phone with many of the members that you've heard today, rigorously going through their programming, critiquing their actions, and really seeing what they do as being a core component of how conflict has ended. We're very lucky to have Nickolay joining us for a few words now, just as the event is coming to an end. So Nickolay, thank you once more for your service, and over to you.
Dear friends, greetings from Jerusalem. I have always been impressed throughout my life with the work that civil society groups around the world have done in peace building. But I must say that the work here in Israel and Palestine, in the Middle East, that organizations have done throughout the last decades to advance contacts between Israelis and Palestinians, to bridge gaps, to find innovative solutions to problems that politicians and statesmen have struggled with, is really, really impressive. I want to thank ALLMEP for this event, for their activities, for all the work that they have done to engage the international community and provide support to all NGOs and civil society groups that are based here on the ground. From our perspective, from the UN's perspective, we have not only been impressed with your work, but we have always felt that it is our responsibility to promote your work and to tell the world about all the silent heroes of peace that Israel and Palestine have. And I must say that after 5 years of working here on the ground, and as I leave this position in the coming months, I will take away with me hope, the hope that really it is not the leaders, the politicians, the statesmen, the military commanders, the bureaucrats who will make peace. It is really people like you, because you are the ones that have worked hard enough and long enough to create opportunities for everyone. And you deserve all the support from all of us and from everyone for to continue your work in an environment that is conducive. We need to help you, we need to protect you, and we need to support you. But so must you in our work as we try and continue to seek peace between the peoples of the Middle East in an environment which is increasingly more difficult and much more challenging on a daily basis. I hope that your work will continue, and I assure you that the United Nations will always stand with you and will always tell your story to the world as it has done until now. Good luck, my friends. Thank you.
All of you who are watching us from different places in the world on different platforms, this is just a glimpse of what ALLMEP is doing. And this is just a small part of what each and every one of us is doing on this land to bring peace. ALLMEP has done an incredible job in such challenging times with such a fairly small team of 8 people in Palestine, in Israel, in USA, and in EU. From DC office, we have Kevin, Abby, Marina, and Sivan. From the Paris office, we have our Joan. And from the regional office, we have Dubi, Wasim, and yours truly. Every individual of ALLMEP's community is a source of light we must strive to keep on. So we all can continue to see the collective light that keeps us hopeful and determined to end this conflict once and for all. Please do keep us in your hearts every time you light a Hanukkah candle, a Christmas tree, or a Ramadan crescent. From ALLMEP, we wish you all a happy Hanukkah, a Merry Christmas, and a very, very healthy New Year, inshallah. Thank you all for not giving up on this work, on us, and for trusting ALLMEP to take our community to the next level. And now I want to leave you with one of our members, the Jerusalem Youth Chorus, performing an inspiring take on My Shot from Hamilton. Enjoy it. Thank you.
Cycle of vengeance and death with no defendants.
I know the action